Servers are something that most people never give much thought to. They're simply the background machines that make the modern world go round. But the world of servers is actually far more fascinating than you might think. The global server market is worth $90 billion, and a lot of household names serve the cloud and server markets as well. This includes Amazon, Google, Microsoft, Dell, Oracle, and Cisco. With this many big players, you would think that the server market is cutthroat and extremely competitive, especially given that their entire customer base is other sophisticated companies as opposed to the general public. But what if I told you that the server market has also been monopolized, not by any one of the common culprits like Google or Amazon, but actually IBM? You see, 96.3% of the world's top web servers all use the same OS, Linux. For perspective, even Windows and Android only have 70% market share. Now, traditionally, Linux is an open source operating system that isn't owned by any one entity and is completely free to use. But this is not the sort of Linux that companies use. Instead, companies prefer to use an enterprise version of Linux. There are a few options here, including Ubuntu, Mint, and Fedora, but one distro rises above everyone else: Red Hat. Red Hat Linux is basically the default choice for companies, and especially large companies. In fact, over 90% of the Fortune 500 uses some sort of enterprise solution from Red Hat. And for the longest time, Red Hat was just a background shadow company that the general public had no clue about. But 4 years ago, IBM decided to change that by purchasing the entirety of Red Hat for a cool $34 billion. So now, it's IBM that controls basically the entire enterprise server OS market. But how did we even get here? How did one company end up getting so much control over the entire world's tech infrastructure? Well, join me as we take a look back at the monumental rise of Red Hat and the landmark deal that has put IBM back on the map. Speaking of legacy products making a comeback, a classic investment that's making a comeback is bonds. You've probably heard about stocks, buying a share of ownership in a company. Bonds are a bit different. You loan money to governments and companies, and they pay you back with interest. Normally, bonds are seen as the boring investment for old people, because while they're generally safer than stock investing, they also come along with low returns of 1-3%. But this has all changed with the new high interest rate environment. Right now, the US federal government themselves are paying 5% for bills that are as short as 1 month to bonds that are as long as 30 years. And companies are paying even more. So if you'd like to lock in these high yields for yourself for the short term or long term, please consider checking out our upcoming bond investing app, Silo, in the description below. But anyway, going back to Red Hat, the story of Red Hat dates back 30 years to a bum named Robert Young. Robert had huge ambitions of running his own company and making it big in the business world. But the reality for Robert was that he was unemployed and broke, working on companies in his wife's sewing closet. His latest endeavor was running a computer supply catalog business, and to get the word out about this business, Robert would regularly attend local tech conferences and try to network with as many people as possible. It was during one of these networking events that Robert would run into a man named Mark Ewing. Mark was your classic 1980s software engineering geek. He spent his childhood summers attending computer camps and writing programs for Apollo and Commodore computers. Within his local community, and especially at college, he was known as the tech guy. And given that he liked wearing red hats, people would begin referring to him as the man in the red hat, and the name stuck. Mark wasn't necessarily looking to start a massive company like Robert, though. In fact, it seems like he preferred the traditional path as he would turn around and get a job at IBM after college. In his free time, though, he would continue meddling with side projects like trying to customize Linux for enterprise use. This project is what would lead Mark to the fateful conference where he met Robert. Robert would convince Mark to let him sell his Linux distros through his new computer supply catalog business, and this marked the beginning of a legendary partnership. At first, it was simply a distribution deal. Robert would sell Mark's Linux CDs. But Robert would end up selling out of these CDs so often that he knew that Mark was onto something. So in 1995, the two would decide to join forces and to create Red Hat Software, with Robert serving as their first CEO. Despite forming a company and having profit incentive though, the duo never really strayed away from their roots. They didn't just go out and file a bunch of patents and trademarks. Instead, they continued to support the open source community as they believed that open collaboration was the best way to create software. This turned out to be a great decision, not just from a community perspective, but from a reach perspective. Being open source gave Red Hat quite a bit of notoriety within the tech community, leading to a lot more adoption. In fact, by 1999, Red Hat would grow to just over $10 million in annual revenue. This was a solid 8-figure business that was realistically worth $30 to $50 million, but combine this with the dot-com bubble and things would go insane. They would IPO with a share price of $14, but by the end of the first trading day itself, the share price would rocket to $52. By the end of the second day, the share price would rocket to $72, giving the company a valuation of $4.8 billion. Red Hat had gone from being a company that Robert ran from his closet to a multi-billion dollar company within just a matter of years. It almost seemed too good to be true, and that's because it was. Moving into the 2000s, Red Hat would face an existential crisis as the company came back down to reality hard. The bottom line was that Red Hat was extremely overhyped and overvalued, at least from a stock perspective, and it's no wonder why. Many investors saw Red Hat as the Windows of servers, and they weren't wrong. Red Hat did end up becoming way more dominant than even Windows in terms of market share, but there's two major differences. First of all, Microsoft was already way bigger than just Windows, and two, there was a lot more money to be made in the consumer market. And when the market realized this, Red Hat stock would get annihilated down to just $4 per share. To make things worse, both Robert and Mark would leave Red Hat in 1999 and 2002 respectively. They didn't leave on bad terms or anything, they actually left on satisfied terms. Sure, they didn't become the next Bill Gates or Steve Jobs, but they had already made hundreds of millions each and they were ready to enjoy life. You can't really blame them, but they kind of did leave Red Hat and all of its employees out to dry. If all of this wasn't bad enough, Red Hat would also start to see new competitors pop up. SUSE Linux Enterprise, for example, came out in 2000, Ubuntu would come out in 2004, and Oracle would follow up with their own version in 2006. The value proposition of Red Hat was starting to disappear despite them continuing to win a bunch of awards. For example, they won the Operating System Product of the Year award 4 years in a row. They would also be ranked number one for value 2 years in a row. But while tech media continued to be nice to Red Hat, Red Hat knew that they had to do something different if they really wanted to stick around. They started thinking about their distro less as a piece of software and more as a solution because, well, the software itself doesn't give them a very big moat. Luckily for Red Hat, everyone was already using their software, so the question wasn't how do we get more customers, but rather how do we keep the customers that we already have? And from that perspective, the answer was easy, by offering world-class support. Support may not seem like a big deal from a consumer perspective, but it's everything from an enterprise perspective. Keep in mind, Red Hat is what's keeping the entire tech infrastructure of companies like Google and Amazon up and running. And for companies of this scale, even 1 hour of downtime is tens of millions of dollars lost. So keeping the backend in pristine condition and getting immediate support when it's not is of utmost importance. This is actually quite ironic given that support was something that Red Hat initially neglected. In fact, in the early days, Robert would actually joke about how the only way to reach Red Hat support was through email, which was counterintuitive given that if your computer needed support, you probably couldn't email in the first place. But moving into the 2000s, Red Hat would approach support from a completely different perspective. In fact, they would add a bunch of pricing tiers to their software that were directly linked to the level of support that they came with. And let's just say, this gets pretty expensive, as much as $2,500 per license. But with that being said, most large corporations view this as a necessity and Red Hat very much does live up to their price. They truly do offer 24/7 first-class white glove tech support. It's easy to spin off another enterprise version of Linux, but matching the support and presence of Red Hat is extremely difficult, and this made way for a new wave of prosperity for Red Hat. After this change in approach, Red Hat would return to setting record after record. In 2009, they would be added to the S&P 500, and just 3 years later, they would become the first open source company to reach $1 billion in annual revenue. By 2015, they would reach $2 billion, and by 2018, they would reach nearly $3 billion. Red Hat was no longer the dot-com boom story that it was back in the 90s. By the late 2000s, Red Hat was a massive tech company offering critical solutions to other massive companies, making billions in the process. In the business world though, when a company reaches extraordinary heights, it's only a matter of time until someone else wants a piece of the pie. In the case of Red Hat, it was the worn down legacy giant, IBM. What IBM really needed was a facelift, a new way to appeal to and attract customers, because almost no modern company really considered IBM as a serious solution. They all flocked to AWS, Azure, Google, and even Oracle Cloud before they even considered IBM. So IBM decided to target a different demographic, a more legacy demographic. Companies like Anthem, American Airlines, Honeywell, Panasonic, Deloitte, and Exxon. According to Arvind Krishna, the CEO of IBM, most of these non-tech companies are only about 20% converted to the cloud. So the idea behind buying Red Hat for $34 billion is that this would make IBM the one-stop shop for legacy companies who just want a simple, straightforward, reliable solution. They don't need the best performance or the fastest response times or any of that. All they wanted was a stress-free migration to the cloud, and that's exactly what IBM was looking to offer. Things have been working out decently well from IBM's perspective, but many would argue that the same cannot be said about Red Hat. It's not that IBM is purposefully making bad choices with Red Hat or anything like that. In fact, you could argue that IBM is genuinely trying their best to respect the open source nature of Red Hat while also trying to improve IBM Cloud as much as possible. With that being said, the problem seems to be much more holistic and qualitative. Many would argue that the bureaucratic old-school ways of IBM are simply rubbing off on Red Hat and bringing down the company. Much of Red Hat's key leadership left the company following the acquisition, and the people who are left, frankly, only care about their own compensation. They don't know the users and they don't care about the product because they've never even used it. This has led to some really unpopular decisions like pushing out unstable upstreams. With that being said though, this does seem to be more of a case of incompetence as opposed to any sort of malicious intent. And as such, we have yet to see any sort of large-scale movement away from Red Hat. But the vocal minority has already started raising several valid red flags, and if IBM continues running Red Hat in the same manner, a shift away from Red Hat may very well be in the cards. So the ball is really in IBM's court. They've somehow been able to covertly overtake an extremely powerful piece of software. But will they actually be able to maintain Red Hat's ubiquity and dominance, or will they fumble the ball? Only time will tell. The crazy part is that this entire company wouldn't even be possible without Linux. If you'd like to see how Linux came to be, check out this video. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.